Hi, I'm Jack from Cheena AI. Today, we're going to explore what neural search is, how it works, and how it's similar to the neural network in your own head. We'll do this using some cute fuzzy animals, and some not-so-cute ones too. But before we dive into neural search, let's back up and think about what search itself actually means. When you think of search, you probably think of something like Google, where you type what you're looking for into a text box and get back a list of links. But search goes well beyond that. Every time you use Shazam, you're searching for matching songs using the audio clip you recorded. And when you look for a date on Tinder, their algorithm is searching for people it thinks you'll like. But search can go even further. What if you could ask any question to a library of academic papers? Or search for the perfect pair of shoes by uploading a picture of the sneakers you love. In short, what if you could use any kind of data to find similar data? With neural search, you can do all of that and more. So, what is neural search? We could give you a dry, technical explanation. Or we could explain it using cute animal pictures. I think we all know which of those will be more interesting. Puppies it is. So, let's look at a few cute doggos. And we can't forget the kitties either. When we look at these critters, what's the first thing we see? First of all, if you're anything like me, you'll notice that they're puppies and kittens. Secondly, we can see how adorably cute they all are. This may seem really obvious, but these are important points. What do we do now we've got all of these cute animals? After taking time to pat them all on the head, let's put them on a line based on how catty or doggy they are. And now, let's look at a few more animals. Except, this time these specimens are not so cute. At least I don't think so. But hey, you do you. Now, where would we put these little bundles of love on our graph? While they are cats and dogs, it feels like we should add another dimension to express there. Let's just say, other characteristics. Let's add another axis to chart how cute or cursed these kitties or puppers are. Then we can place them in the appropriate section of our graph. Moving forwards, let's learn a few terms that are common in deep learning. First, we've got our dimensions. These are the criteria we use to determine where to place a piece of data on our graph. In this example, we only have two dimensions, but this can be any number, as we'll see later. Next, we've got our vector embeddings. These are our individual data points embedded into our graph and can be expressed as a set of coordinates. In our example, we have two dimensions, so our embeddings are expressed with just two numbers. In our graph, each cat or dog has its own embedding for a total of 10 embeddings. Let's put all of them together. We'll refer to this as the index. Now you've taken the time to learn those terms, you deserve another cute pup as a reward. If we wanted to find a similar puppy from our dataset of animals, how would we do that? This seems pretty simple. But that's because our brains do it automatically every day. Let's look at our graph again. If we were going to put our new puppy anywhere on this graph, where would we put them? Well, they're a puppy, and they're cute. So they go here in the index, right next to all the other cute pups. When we look at the dataset, which animal is the closest match to the puppy we just placed on the graph? That's right, we just found the puppy's nearest neighbor. In this case, it's another cute, fuzzy snowball. Working with dimensions, embeddings, and indexes is something we do automatically. Usually we don't even think about how it works. The brain in your head is a network of neurons and synapses. In short, it's a neural network. And just like biological neural networks, digital neural networks operate in the same way. They build an index based on the dimensions of the data they're given and can find similar data based on the nearest neighbors. It's using its neurons to search for data. In short, it's neural search. This can go well beyond a simple two-dimensional graph. For example, every time you eat, your brain is receiving sensations about the food in your mouth. How sweet is it? Or maybe it's salty. Is it crunchy or squishy? Every food you eat is embedded in an index in your neural network, based on dimensions like saltiness, chewiness, and so on. And if a digital neural network is looking at 3D models, it may build an index based on how spiky or round the model is, how concentrated its individual points are, and so on. Every neural network has its own strengths and weaknesses. Both dolphins and squirrels have neural networks in their heads. But if you ask a dolphin to gather nuts or a squirrel to catch fish, then you'll have two very unhappy animals to deal with. Likewise, you wouldn't use a neural network trained on videos to search for text or a French language neural net to search for Chinese. So, where does Gina fit into all of this? Gina is an open-source framework that allows you to build your own neural search application for any kind of data. In our next video, we'll explore some of the key concepts behind Gina and how you can get up and running. Thanks for watching our video on neural search. For more information, visit our GitHub repo at the link below or check out the other videos on our channel. This is Jack from Gina AI signing off. Have a great day.